Hi, thank you. So the preacher, Miguel Brun, told a story a few years ago that he had visited a native community in Paraguay. He was part of an evangelizing mission, and the missionaries actually met a local chief who was considered very, very wise. And the chief, which was a quiet man, listened without blinking to the religious texts that they read to him in his own language. When the missionaries finished, they awaited their chief's reaction. The chief took his time, and then he said, "That scratches. It scratches very hard and it scratches very well." And then he added, "But it scratches where there isn't any itch." Now, I have been working with people with disabilities for the past decade in the development of all sorts of technologies that support their daily activities. And some of my early work was on prosthetics, so I'm just going to show you a quick video of a sensor I designed, which you will see on my wrist, covered with a black elastic, with a black elastic band. And this sensor can actually measure the vibrations that muscles produce as they contract. And as you can see here, it can be used to control a robotic hand. We got quite a lot of papers published on this and got a lot of media attention. Discovery Channel was all over it, and so on. Another example of the technologies I've worked on is an algorithm that enables access to very complex systems by means of very limited interfaces. So an example of this may perhaps involve someone with severe physical impairments who may have access to a single on-off switch, but still may be able to play a complex or relatively complex video game, such as the one you'll see here. And again, this is being entirely played with a single switch and the algorithm I developed. And I won't have the chance to show the full video, but it does have a happy ending. The player actually manages to collect all the points and reach the goal before the time runs out. Another great thing about this algorithm is that it enables access to very unstructured and therefore also very difficult to access activities such as drawing. So this is once more another example of one of the drawings that our research collaborator Michael Tura created, again using only one switch and the algorithm I developed. Now, right about the time that I was working on this algorithm, I started working for a community-based organization that provides people with disabilities with the opportunity to connect with engineers, craftsmen, technicians, really anyone who can help them solve some of the access issues they face on a daily basis. And coincidentally, one of the first projects I got involved with was with Linda, a lady with physical impairments who also wanted to paint. So I thought, you know, what a wonderful opportunity to apply this research. So I went to visit Linda and her therapist, and I talked to them about my work, and they both listened without blinking to my presentation on the wonderful features of my algorithm. And when I finished, I awaited their reaction, and they took their time. And then what they said can basically be probably best summarized as follows. It wasn't a very lucky experience. This is the picture of the actual setup that we used. It involved a standard camera mount, standard bolt and nut, and a $10 mini easel. Now compare that to about $100,000 spent on my PhD. So that's significant. What I want to talk to you about today is both the tremendous limitations that the systems that we currently have to provide people with disabilities with the tools they need to achieve their goals, and the very exciting emerging opportunities that I believe hold the key to their solution. So we'll start with the limitations, and I think I have already hinted at one of them, and that's the tendency of research and researchers in this area to just overcomplicate things. Now, this is not very surprising, of course. It will be very, very hard to publish a peer-reviewed scientific paper on a solution as simple as the one I showed you a moment ago. And on the other hand, we do have advanced knowledge in things like mathematics and electronics. And, you know, paraphrasing Avram Maslow, if all you have is a hammer, everything does start looking a lot like a nail. Of course, the problem with this approach is that it ends up being a lot more like finding problems to specific solutions as opposed to finding solutions to a given problem. Yet another limitation stems from the application of standard commercialization models, which are typically designed for massive consumer markets, to the disability context in which markets tend to be a lot smaller and where individuals' needs are very distinct from one another. So just to give you an example, every year in all of Canada and the US, there are only about 500 people with hand amputations that will be eligible to receive a robotic hand like the one I showed you in the first video. And right off the bat, half of them will actually never bother to use a prosthesis because it will just be too much of a hassle for what it's worth. And of the ones that actually do use a prosthesis, only about 30% of them will go for the robotic hand because the alternative, which is a body-powered hook, is a lot cheaper and just easier to maintain. Now, you may say you cannot put a price on restoring hand function for someone who has lost a limb. This prosthesis can end up costing up to $100,000, which may stem from the fact that the market is very, very small. But the problem is that the technology is so limited that people have to work around it every day anyways. So I'll just show you an example of a video of Michael, who has a prosthesis, but cannot use it to go fishing with his dad.
All right,
so,
what's
that? What his dad basically did was simply went to a store, bought a toy fishing rod and some PVC piping, and attached it directly to his son's cast. And you can see Michael here practicing his fishing with his new $15 prosthesis that also actually came with a neat backpack and sunglasses. And this is, you have to understand here that there's no commercial prosthesis that can allow anyone to do this as naturally, as naturally as what Michael and his dad Robert achieved, just with some ingenuity and a trip to Walmart. And they're not the only ones who have realized this. The Center for International Rehabilitation Network has published online instructions on how to attach any terminal element to prostheses made actually out of plastic soda bottles. And you can see in the inset there how they make them just using a heat gun. This is just an example for painting. And this is particularly interesting because people with hand amputations do not really face constant limitations. If you think about it, a lot of the things you do with two hands, you can also do with one hand. So they tend to talk a lot more about not being able to do very, very specific things like cutting their own meat than about the fact that they don't have hand. However, for those of us who still have both of our hands, the thought of losing one is so difficult to bear that we immediately assume that the best solution is the high-tech robotic hand, and we skip right past simple and affordable alternatives like this one. This is John Cunningham, an engineer who lost an arm in Iraq. And he actually founded Open Prosthetics, which is an online community that invites people with amputations and other interested parties from all over the world to share their designs, their ideas, their resources with the objective of creating functional and inexpensive prostheses. And this has actually happened in other contexts as well. So we have Michael Curran there, a blind developer from Australia, who started in 2006 the project Non-Visual Desktop Access Project, which has the objective of developing screen readers for people with blindness so they can access a Windows operating system. Similarly, Monty Lipburn here with Sean Kirkpatrick from Vancouver have been working since 2004 in the development of software that runs on standard mobile phones and facilitate GPS-based navigation for people with visual impairments. And you know, both of these technologies are open source, of course, and available for free. So rather than making money or publishing scientific articles, the goal of these user-driven initiatives is simply to scratch their own itch. They also understand design as a highly iterative and never-ending process. So the resulting communities become highly distributed and collaborative, and openly publish their work online in the hopes of attracting casual reviewers that may be able to contribute an enhancement or two while browsing by. Alternative business models can and have been developed based on consulting, training, support, and even custom development, all of which can be offered for a fee. But most significantly, the elimination of intellectual property barriers not only allows people, users, to hack and share their own adaptations, but also enables the creation of local service markets anywhere, so that people don't have to rely anymore on a single provider, like is usually the case. Like my friend Maria back in Toronto, who had to wait for about a month without being able to leave her apartment for the technician from the one company that could fix her wheelchair. And I don't know about you, but I think in a country like Canada, this is just unacceptable. Jay Rogers, CEO of an interesting open source car manufacturing company in the States, has a really neat analogy to explain the potential of open innovation in addressing the needs of niche communities. Products are like marbles in a jar, he says. They fill some space, but there's a lot of space in between that they cannot reach. And what we have to realize is that we all live in the spaces in between because products are not designed for us, they're designed for people like us. So we don't use them because they're good, we use them because they're good enough. Now, if I had prepared this presentation back when I was a grad student, I kind of looked like that. I would have probably called for some, ask you to join me in a call for some kind of revolution. But now that I've had a lot more time to think about this, I realize that rather than revolution, this is more like the evolution of our systems of production. And see, a century ago, the Industrial Revolution allowed us to create better and cheaper goods, but we, almost all of us, had to give up the ability to tailor them, to customize them to our own needs and preferences. Nowadays, however, these same systems of mass production and more recently digital technologies have made our tools and our knowledge so cheap and so accessible that creating and even acquiring and even making for ourselves very highly customized products and services is becoming ridiculously easy. Take, for example, the cupcake here by MakerBot Industries. This is a desktop printer capable of turning 3D designs into real 3D objects. And you can actually literally go home today and download a couple of programs off the internet and create some basic designs that you can shape off to companies like Shapeways, which will use this kind of technology to print your object, your design, in plastic or other materials, and then mail it back to your home. Or you can just buy the cupcake for about $1,000 and print as many things as you want. Of course, communities like the folks at Open Prosthetics have already realized the potential of these technologies and have even started to duplicate and enhance some of the designs for prostheses available today. So this is a Tautman hook printed on a 3D printer. So from my perspective, I think the context of assistive technology design has been disrupted and exposed wide open from the bottom up, and is ready to nurture the visionaries that will be able to realize its potential. So maybe one of you will be the businessman or woman who will be able to tap into the new market of semi-disposable prosthesis attachments, or you may be the policymaker who will save perhaps a lot of money to your province by promoting open licensing models. I think there's a lot of opportunities here. But most importantly, you know, as you leave today, I'd like you to think about the fact that the handful of innovations by people with disabilities that I introduced to you today have all been made in spite of the barriers that we've placed in their way. Disability is not an illness. It is more the product of badly designed environments and, most of all, discriminatory contexts. And I'd like to leave you with a phrase by Tania Tyshkovsky from the University of Toronto, and that is, there are hundreds of people with disabilities missing from our schools, our workplaces, and our public spaces because the physical or social barriers that we have put in their place prevent them from being there or from participating or from having their voice heard. We often like to think about what to do for people with disabilities, but I think we ought to think about what to stop doing to break the cycles that keep them excluded. Thank you.